26 days ago today that Joe Biden said, quote, I've done all I can do. He was asked about why he wouldn't use his extensive executive authority to address the border catastrophe that he himself created. And 126 days ago, he looked into the cameras and said, I'm out of options. I've done all I can do. He tried to convince us all for all this time that there was no way he could possibly fix the mess. Remember that he engineered it. When Congressman Ciscomani said a few moments ago, he began this on the day he took office over 3.5 years ago. He walked into the Oval Office and he started issuing executive orders, dozens of them. We counted 64 specific executive actions that President Biden and Secretary Mayorkas took to open that border wide. They did it intentionally. They engineered the open border. There's no question about it. The evidence is so clear.
Welcome to the program. Dana Loesch here with you. Always good. We're at the top of this first hour here. And I tried to retweet because a lot of people will tune in. I'd say that we're streaming on X, but I don't know what the hell's happening because I'm apparently not able to post on X for some reason. I don't know, because I don't have anything nice to say that's FCC compliant. So do you want to keep pushing me on this issue? Because
banned?
It's going to get real quick.
Were you banned?
I'm not banned. I just nothing. The only thing that's new is the stuff that I put there last night. Like, none of my retweets are going through. Nothing's actually
really?
Going through. So I don't.
All right, I'm going to check this out.
I don't really know what's happening. I can't see anything. And it doesn't show up in different browsers. And I've been jacked around so long. I've had over 1 million followers deleted. I don't even know anymore. It's like sometimes I wake up and I'm like, what the F is the point of even getting on social media at this point? Because it's run by a bunch of hippie fascists. It's run by a bunch of people who didn't accomplish anything other than their life, anything in their lives except for be a zealot, a political zealot. And then they go, and you can't see anything either, can you?
No.
Yeah, none of my stuff
Nothing,
is posted.
As of last night was all there is.
Yeah, so I'm not able to post. So I don't know. We'll see what happens. But it actually then becomes a professional issue because that's we stream on the show. We stream the show on X. And, I like share a lot of stuff on X. So that's it. I don't know. We'll see. I'm about ready to leave the platform. I'm literally about ready to delete all of my social media accounts. I am a heartbeat away. I am so done. I am so done with it because they're all garbage. Every one of them. There is not one that has a redeeming value. And X needs to get its stuff together. I'm not going to sit here and pay. I like Musk a lot, but I think he needs to just gut the whole damn thing. People may have to go without it for a while because it's such a mess. And this is the stuff we're talking about. I mean, maybe it doesn't affect you immediately, but it affects what you see. It affects the stuff that you see. It affects how you get your information. It affects also what is amplified and what isn't amplified. But because a lot of the stuff that ends up coming up on social media is what breaks everything now. And then you have the networks that break everything later. We talked about this a little bit yesterday. But I'm done. I am so done in fighting that battle. Honestly. I mean, I've been doing this since 2006. Actually, I was like a year into Twitter launching. I opened an account on Twitter because I started in the blogosphere. I was a newspaper columnist and I started in the blogosphere. And I'm just so done with it already. I'm curious as to what you guys think because I'm literally about to delete my account. I'm done. I'm done dealing with it. I'm not going to sit here and pay money to get throttled and deal with this BS. I'm done. So, I don't know. Maybe there'll be an account later today. Maybe there won't be because I'm about ready to delete all of it. So, we'll see. That's going to be really nice for our social media team. It may not be there, guys. I'm done. I can only do so much and I got a bandwidth of GAFs, okay?
But the memes though.
The memes though. You know what? I love the memes, but I'm about done. I'm just about done with it all. Seriously. It's really frustrating. And I'm just every damn day, it's something different. Every damn day. So let's get to some of this other stuff in this hellscape that we call a free republic, right? Or that we pretend is still a free republic. We're in that mood today. I'm just wanting to let you know. So Hunter Biden, the privileged son of the president, he started his trial today. I just think it's embarrassing that you have the First Lady of the United States who is walking into the courtroom on a gun trial with her stepson because he's a drug user, right? I mean, walking in behind him, it's so frustrating. It's just embarrassing to see this because he's on trial for being a drug user and purchasing a gun. I want the whole book thrown at him. I want the maximum penalty. No. I'm done with it. I want to see him in shackles. I want him perp walk into the pokey. That's what I want to see happen. So I want to see that happen. I want him perp walked. I want the whole entire book thrown at him. I don't want any of these Republicans to show any mercy or suffer any fools. Let the fire of the burning, flaming bridges light the path going forward. I want full on complete destruction. Dracarys, go. That's what I want. So you have Dr. Gill who walks in with him. At least she didn't walk in her best Dolce & Gabbana floral sofa print. Walked into the courthouse with him, and then also his half-sister, also a drug addict, Ashley, walked in. That whole family's a mess. They don't even care about the optics. Just think of this. You got Jill Biden walking into a courtroom where Hunter Biden is being charged with lying on a 4473. Your basic average rando American backside would have been thrown in a jail cell already. But see, he won the DNA lottery. He was born of a grifter family, right? A white trash. Sorry, white trash. That's an insult to white trash. What's under that? We got to come up with something. He was born into this very privileged family, a grifter family. And so he gets all of the benefits of that. So he has this, he's got like this Teflon aesthetic to him. Nothing sticks. So he's there. Then you go to Ashley Biden, who is in the news because also a drug addict, and she abandoned her diary. It was months and months and months. Abandoned her diary at a flop house. It was a friend's house that she used to flop in. And I was actually talking to some people who were in the know about this. It was down in Florida. And she stayed at this friend's house, this flop house, and left some of her stuff, including her diary, for months and months and months. Then only when the excerpts of it come out and embarrass her and her family does she claim that it's stolen. Now, everyone else, they'd be like, girl, you left this for seven. This was 7 months ago. This diary, you left this diary go over almost going on a year. Is it over 7 months? You left this diary forever ago. So, you know, maybe you shouldn't be a drug using promiscuous person and you should keep track of your belongings like a normal functioning human. And so then that's when she filed suit, blah, 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 all this other stuff. Their whole family's a mess. And to see Jill Biden walk in like she's doing her duty as some proud mother hen, you're not a good mother. Your kids are a mess. Your daughter that you had with your husband's a mess. Your stepkids are a mess. You're horrible parents. Clearly, you don't believe in cause and effect. You don't believe in consequences. And it's just embarrassing. For all the stuff that they sit here and say about Trump, you never have ever seen any of the Trump kids have this issue, have you? Never. Even Don Jr. that got a divorce. It was a very classy divorce. I mean, I wish, you know, it's sad. I wish they wouldn't have. I don't like to see a marriage with kids fall apart. But it was classy. You know what I mean? Like there was no mudslinging. There was no somebody got drunk or high and threw a gun in a trash can. There was none of that stuff, right? There were no naked pictures where your flabby, you know, overhang is over your undercarriage and you're holding a gun with your finger on the trigger taking selfies. I mean, there was none of that stuff that came up, right? There's no pictures of you sleeping with your crack pipe. None of that stuff came up. You never had anything like that with those kids. So I don't even want to hear all the left talk trash. You guys have the worst, sluttiest, trashiest politicians that you could possibly have. You got a guy that got a BJ in the Oval Office, right? You got another guy that was fleecing this old lady, Bunny Mellon, down in the Carolinas so that he could sit here and pay for his out-of-wedlock baby mama. You had that to deal with. You got the Bidens to deal with. I mean, where do we stop? Where do we stop? Let's look at the hot mess that you guys call leaders. I don't want to hear another damn thing about Trump. Oh my gosh. Clean up your own house. Jiminy. It's like a Jerry Springer episode. Just call it the Jerry Springer party. Good night. Anyway, I got that out of my system for now. For now. Now that being said, there's a piece up. Lorraine's got a really good piece up over at Substack. Meet the jury. Now, this is interesting because I go back and forth. It's immediately determined in favor of the Bidens. Where it is, where the trial is taking place, where the jury is being selected from. It's immediately in favor of the Bidens, right? So it's not like I'm kind of, I don't know if they're going to get what they want to get the prosecution out of this. But Lorraine has a piece up. I tweeted it out, but I'm not sure if it's, again, it's been all weird over there. It's up again, Substack, chapter and verse. And there are some gun owners that are members of the jury. So you have the jury, you've got the alternates, as Lorraine notes in here. So you have, I love, juror number three watches CBS Evening News every night. It's her only regular source of news. Kane rolled his eye. You might want to pick your eyeballs up on the floor. You roll them out of your head. Are you all right over there?
I'll make it.
That is the most exaggerated eye roll I've ever seen in the history of eye rolls. She has a sister who struggled with drugs, but's currently clean. See, they ask you all these questions, as you know, when you sit for a jury. I would have never made this jury. Juror number five used to work for Secret Service in D.C. That can go either way, as did her husband. Because there's six men, six women. Juror 16 gets her news from YouTube. She said her mom owns a gun, but she has no experience. So she's ambivalent. Juror number 19 thinks people who smoke pot should be allowed to own guns. So she's a libertarian. She's going to side with Hunter Biden on that aspect of the defense. But she's also probably big gun rights. This is weird, isn't it? Isn't it weird? This is where they're coming into. Juror number 26, this is a progressive's worst nightmare. It's a middle-aged black man. They love jailing black Second Amendment supporters like Dexter Taylor. I mean, all of a sudden that, you know, they just get all Jim Crow about everything. He says that he's got a concealed carry permit in Delaware and Florida. He thinks Second Amendment is important. There's a younger male whose father owns some guns. So juror number 33, this is the one that's going to be interesting. He lost his dad to a quote-unquote gun crime. He's got a brother who was arrested for possession. It served a year in jail. Mm. So this is it. There's a woman who owns a gun. So there's some gun owners in this case. Then there's a guy who has a brother. He has a history of drug abuse. His family has drug abuse history, PCP, heroin, because that's all going to come into play. Then they got the alternates. This is it's going to be interesting. But still, remember, Democrats from like D.C. and Delaware and all that area, Republicans or gun owners from that area are a little different than like, say, gun owners or Republicans from like Texas or Florida or the Carolinas. So, you know, you can't tell. We're going to get into all of that. We're also going to be following. Joe Biden's going to be signing this executive order that he wasn't able to sign because he couldn't do anything about the border until all of a sudden it looked bad for him in the polls. We're going to cover all of that so you don't want to miss. We got a lot to hit today as we move. So you know how important being prepared is to me, and that's why I want you to know about my good friends at ReadyWise Emergency Food. Now, you've heard me talk about them as Wise Foods. ReadyWise Emergency Food is the same company, but with more options. Being prepared with ReadyWise Emergency Food gives you peace of mind that you'll have delicious, nutritious meals on hand to feed your family. They're also great for fishing and hunting and hiking adventures. They have a huge selection of freeze-dried meals from breakfast to pasta dishes that'll be good to eat when you need it with their 25-year shelf life. ReadyWise is an American company, so that means you're supporting American jobs when you choose ReadyWise. Visit ReadyWise.com and use promo code Dana20 at checkout for 20% off of any regularly priced item. That's ReadyWise.com, promo code Dana20.
And now, all of the news you would probably miss. It's time for Dana's Quick Five.
So this is interesting because I read a whole deep dive about this last night about why cancer is increasing in younger people. And it's actually because they're eating too much sugar and not enough fiber. It has been a trend, I will say. It was a trend before the pandemic and the vaccines. The injections. I'm not saying that word. Just like I don't say Palestine, because that's not a word that exists either.
But it sure has shot up since the vax.
Yeah, I know. The turbo stuff, I'm sure it's not the injections. Anyway, the Telegraph is saying obesity is being blamed for the disturbing rises in cancer amongst younger people. Obesity is just another side effect of it. That's not the big issue. The issue is people are not consuming enough fiber and enough vegetables. Also, they're kind of sedentary. They need to get up and move a little bit more. I mean, seriously, when we were over in Italy, I literally ate pasta three times a day and I had gelato twice a day, but I walked like 10 miles everywhere. That's why they don't gain weight, because you gotta walk everywhere. I'm just saying, maybe like that could be a little bit more applicable here, just, you know, suggesting it. but it's the sugar and lack of fiber. No one's eating fiber. That's crazy to think that it's just something that could be potentially that simple. More than 10,000, oh my gosh, 10,000 human remains uncovered on a suspected, suspected serial killer's farm. This is in Tampa, Florida. This was a serial killer they've been working for decades to try to identify the victims of the suspected serial killer. It was discovered at Fox Hollow Farm, the home of Herb Baumeister, 1996. They identified a guy who disappeared in August of 93. They still have 10,000 charred human remains, and they've only identified 3 victims so far. That's wild. Goodness. Louisiana lawmakers approved a bill allowing for the surgical castration for child molesters, and bravo, Louisiana lawmakers. Bravo. I think they should be put to death, preferably. I think that they should be immediately killed following the trial. They should just immediately have a rope put around their neck, dragged out to the back, and shot by firing squad. I got so much more time. People are like, a solar project is destroying thousands of Joshua trees out in Joshua Tree State Park, you know, for the environment. Stick with us. Are you concerned about the increasing instability in the world today because we have a bunch of desiccated old geezers who can't do math making monetary policy? You're not alone. We're all worried about what the future holds, but there is something that we can do about it. So that's why I've taken steps to safeguard my savings by going full Scrooge McDuck and diversifying precious metals with gold and silver. So after thorough research, I wanted to go with Gold Co. It's a reputable company with a proven track record, and with their guidance, you know, you feel confident with your decisions. Gold Co. is a 7-time Inc. 5000 winner. They've helped individuals like us secure over $2.5 billion in gold and silver investments, and they're offering up to $10,000 in bonus silver. But you got to act fast because the supplies are limited. So join me in protecting your financial future. Visit DanaLikesGold.com, because boy, don't I, and learn more and take the first step towards financial security. So by visiting the site, you'll also get a complimentary wealth protection kit to help you navigate inflation, geopolitical uncertainties, economic instability. But don't wait until it's too late. Visit DanaLikesGold.com today and start securing your future. That's DanaLikesGold.com.
There's a difference between the viruses that were funded by the NIH subaward versus anything else anybody else in China might be doing.
Excellent. You were talking about what you funded.
What we funded, and all right. That's the point.
And that goes to my next question, because I thought you might go there, and I appreciate that.
Right.
Because in an off-the-record member-level briefing in February of 2022, I asked about the likelihood and nature of a SARS-related coronavirus to have a furin cleavage site, particularly since it takes the 12 nucleotide change in there to make it as viral as this was going on. And at the time, you said to me pretty much what you just said, and I want you to just confirm it for the record. Well, that wasn't us. If that was being done, it wasn't us. Yeah. And you confirmed that for the record, yes?
No,
it wasn't you. It wasn't what you were funding.
What I'm saying is that I cannot account, nor can anyone account, for other things that might be going on in China, which is the reason why I have always said and will say now, I keep an open mind as to what the origin is.
Yeah. We know what it was. Like, why are we sitting here playing this game? That was Dr. Anthony Fauci. Welcome back to the program. By the way, related to this, did you guys see the image that I shared with you? If you're a subscriber over at Substack, Chapter and Verse, one of my favorite things to do is find images to lead the headlines with every morning. There was a lady who was in the room in the chamber yesterday when they were doing this hearing, and she had a Jail Fauci Now shirt on, and that apparently it made him mad. That made him mad, and then there was a dude who sat behind him. I don't know if y'all saw this dude that sat behind Fauci, who was like a mime. And he was mocking him and rolling his eyes and talking back, like, under his breath and all of this stuff. And that ticked him off so bad. Is that what that's what he's responding to in Audio Soundbite 5, right? Yeah. He's mad.
Yeah, he's mad.
Over
the death threats, you mean that?
Well, he's like, what's a January 6th defendant doing here? Is what he was saying.
Oh, Lord.
And it's like, well, if you're going to sit here and ask questions about what people are doing where... I mean, I got more for you. But the lady, wasn't this an old lady or is that an old man? I think that's an old lady. She doesn't have an apple. And remember, if they got an apple, they got a banana, kids. Right? That's the lesson. That's the lesson for the day. Have a great day.
It's an elder.
I mean, and he's got a jail Fauci shirt on. He did, and right, sitting right down from him. That was the lead image for headlines today for Substack, for my newsletter. She's wearing this. It's so perfect. It's so perfect.
See, what the government hates is that both sides of the political aisle can find some unification in understanding what Fauci did to the country.
Yeah.
And his, at least his contribution to it based on his expertise. At least we can unify.
Because science came.
We could totally unify over this. The government does not want that.
No, they don't want this at all. It's so bad, that's why they don't want it at all. Not at all. I loved that image, though. Loved that image. So his ongoing, like he threw the CDC under the bus. He admitted that all of this stuff didn't have any kind of science to back it. They just made up the social distancing. Does anybody else, when you go into a store and you still see the little feet stickers on the floor where you're supposed to stand because you're apparently too stupid to figure out, you know, how to not get up in someone's space? I never pay attention to those. Ever. Never. I didn't even at the time. And I just, when I'm told to do something, you guys feel this too. I know you do, because that's why you listen to the show and watch the simulcast that you can watch on channel 347 or Rumble or YouTube or Facebook or wherever. But whenever someone tells you that you got to do something, you don't want to do it, right? Because that's the American DNA in you. I don't care if you were born somewhere else and you came here and became a citizen. I don't care. That's your American DNA that's speaking to you. And there's something satisfyingly unifying about that I really enjoy. But this guy was sitting there, and I was still going through some of the hearing yesterday, last night. And I want to touch on audio soundbite 4, because he's trying to defend the association with Wuhan. I want to real quickly flash back real fast, because remember when you had those, it was like a... it was like a diplomatic group, Kane. Remember, it was some of our scientists and researchers, and then some scientists and researchers from elsewhere, and they went to the Wuhan Institute. Because if you remember, at the time, the Wuhan Institute was lauded as being, it's the state-of-the-art leading viral research facilities in the world, super safe, super secure, meticulously clean. I mean, they bragged and bragged and bragged on it. And so we had like this consortium of researchers and scientists that went. And apparently that's when, if you think back when there were those secret cables that were sent to the State Department, where you had some of the members of this group that were there touring the facility in Wuhan. Go back to remember the original reports, and these cables were released. They were surreptitiously taken and released later. But it emerged that they were actually warning the State Department, this is bad. Something's going to happen here. This is bad. And these cables first came to light, I want to say in March, after everything started shutting down. And then the story went away, and you never heard anything else about it. You all remember this, right? Can you remember the story of the members on this scientific expedition to the Wuhan Institute of Virology? They were there to take in, it was like a diplomatic scientific thing with not just the U.S. and China, but several other countries. And they were sending these cables back, and they were classified, or not classified, they were secret, top secret. They sent these cables back. And they were saying, this is bad. Something's wrong here. This is bad. So, there's going to be an accident. I mean, they were warning them. And then lo and behold. I mean, they were really trying to shut all of that down. So keep that in mind. Audio soundbite 4. He's trying to defend the Chinese collaboration. This was Fauci yesterday. Listen.
You know, Caitlin, if you look at the history, going back decades of collaborations with Chinese scientists, we're not talking about Chinese officials. We're talking about Chinese scientists who've collaborated with the European Union, with the United States, with Canada, with Australia. A lot of very good, important science that has contributed to global health has come from collaborations with the Chinese. Now, obviously, because of the tension that's gone on right now, that's changed a bit, and I hope it gets back to normality, where there can be mutual benefit of international collaboration among scientists, the way it's been for decades.
Now, the Washington Post had this story on April 14th, 2020. Along with Politico, etc. In July 17th, that's when the cables were actually published. And what they discovered is that this event, now the expedition, this little scientific expedition, which you had scientists and researchers and a couple of diplomats, this took place in 2018. So they were warned 2 years in advance. The 2018 cable that was released detailed these U.S. embassy, because there were some people, there were diplomats that went with them from the U.S. embassy. And they said that when they were touring this lab in Wuhan, that there were some serious protocol abridgments here. And they said there was an absence of adequately trained personnel. And the cables, there were three pages that were finally released in full. And they said that after SARS, China wanted to prioritize international cooperation for infectious disease control. But then they got into, like, for instance, some of it's redacted. They said that the utilization, they're talking about this one lab that was supposed to be fully accredited. And it's the BSL-4 lab that was, you know, supposed to be highly celebrated, etc. Limited by a lack of access to different organisms, opaque government review and approval processes. And they said that a lack of commitment to basically securing against infection in Beijing with these highly pathogenic viruses. They said it remains in doubt. They said that Redacted noted that the new lab has a serious shortage of, this is verbatim from this, has a serious shortage of appropriately trained technicians and investigators needed to safely operate this high containment laboratory. They said that they noted the University of Texas Medical Branch in Galveston. They also have a BSL-4 lab. This is like a level of this. They said that they have scientific collaborations with the Wuhan Institute of Virology. It said it may help alleviate the talent gap over time. But they said that they're trying to figure out, because the Wuhan Institute was advertised as being the gold standard. And they say in here, they basically say, how in the world this is the gold standard? We have no idea. That's what they say in this thing. So they said that that the scientists are undertaking this research, but they have limitations, etc. And they list, you know, a few examples. But they sent these cables. They were warning them of risky experiments done by staff that essentially were not. They did not have the skill set to be undertaking these experiments, nor did they have a security and containment protocol in place to even undertake these experiments. This is what came out in these cables in 2018. And nobody did anything. And that was Washington Post who first had it, then Politico, and then it went from there. So this is it's pretty wild that he says, oh, well, there's collaboration. What did we get from the collaboration? I mean, just think, just go along with it and just let's just say, okay, fine. We had some, you know, we had no collaboration in containment. We had no collaboration in identification. When even we were looking at the genome sequencing of this virus, China was refusing to cooperate after. And not just with Taiwan. China was refusing to release anything that they had uncovered. Every other world government was sharing their information except for China. So I find Fauci's explanation that there's apparently a lot of science that contributed to global health that came from collaborations with the Chinese, I find that really hard to accept as anything other than a weak defense of his own actions and involvement, considering it was China's refusal to collaborate that made this pandemic more ridiculous, last longer, and probably cost a hell of a lot more lives. I want to go back for a moment with this. You want to talk about collaboration with the Chinese? One of my favorite things to examine is how this thing kicked off and where it kicked off the most. Let's flash back to 2020, back when you had Fashion Week in Milan, Italy. Buckle up. I'm going to bring this tugboat to shore. So several years before the pandemic in Italy, and this is in Tuscany, you have, everybody knows where Florence is, right? You have the leather tanning, you know, the real politic was born in Florence. You know, I mean, politics as we know it was, you know, modern politics was born there. And then just a little bit to the northwest of Florence is a region called Prato, and that's where a lot of these manufacturing facilities, et cetera, are. For generations, you had a skilled Italian craftsman that would hand down the tools of their trade generation to generation. So you would have multiple generations of the same, you know, skilled trade family doing this. This is why, one of the reasons why Italian leather work was so valued and considered, you know, the best of the best, because there were so many generations that went into perfecting the techniques, etc. And so you had a lot of business people from China move in after Italy's economy suffered, because they had socialists in government. After their economy suffered, they had a lot of hiccups, businesses were going under, and you know, all the drama with the EU, you had a lot of Chinese businessmen coming in and scooping up these facilities, scooping up these manufacturing facilities, purchasing these historically, you know, generationally run manufacturing bases. And they did it so that they could sell luxury goods to the public, and it would be a Chinese-owned and Chinese-ran, but they could have the made in Italy label, intimating that they were the same skilled Italian craftsmen, except they weren't. They got rid of all of them, and they brought in illegal Chinese labor. It was a huge, dramatic event that took place in Italy. There were protests in the streets with Italians protesting the presence of illegal Chinese immigrants that were flooding into the region and working in these newly acquired facilities. And the Chinese were calling the Italians racist. They shamed the Italians into silence. So the Italians stopped protesting. Fast forward a couple of years when there were direct flights from Wuhan to the Tuscan area, from Wuhan to Florence. There were direct flights to this area every day. And this was the hotspot that busted out in Italy. And it went from this area to Milan Fashion Week, because you got people in Milan Fashion Week. They're going to check out these facilities. And one of the reasons that this story broke open is because a lot of luxury goods like Fendi and others, their quality dropped off. Because they went from having skilled Italian tradesmen do their leather work and their sewing, et cetera, to Chinese illegal immigrants that were doing a crappy job. And it was Vogue even had to, you know, submit itself to writing a little piece about it, because it was a huge scandal in the fashion world. So anyway, fast forward a couple of years, and you have the virus that breaks out. And the governor of the region actually told the press that the reason why they didn't say anything from the beginning when they noticed people getting sick is they didn't want to be called racist again by the Chinese. That's how this happened. That's the big contributing factor, the second big contributing factor on why that broke out. Unbelievable, right? We got to move. Folks, a movement to change how we elect our president is growing, led by radical left-wing activists who don't think that their side should ever have to lose the presidency again. They seek to do away with the Electoral College as devised by the framers of our Constitution. And that's why my friends at Hillsdale College are conducting a national survey on presidential selection. Hearing directly from informed patriots like you is critical. So please take the Hillsdale National Survey on presidential selection today at dana4hillsdale.com to help Hillsdale understand the views of mainstream Americans on the critical issue of presidential selection. Just visit dana4hillsdale.com to start your national survey on the presidential selection right now.
Like sands through the hourglass, so are the days of the United States.
It all started from the national championship game, and I've been dealing with this for 2 years now. And understanding, like, yeah, negative things have probably been said about me, but honestly, I'll take that, because look where women's basketball is. People are talking about women's basketball that you never would think that we'd be talking about women's basketball. People are pulling up to games. We got celebrities coming to games, sold out arenas, like, just because of one single game. And just looking at that, like, I'll take that role. I'll take the bad guy role, and I'll continue to take that on and be that for my teammates. And if I want to be that, and I know I'll go down in history, I'll look back in 20 years and be like, yeah, the reason why we watching women's basketball is not just because of one person. It's because of me, too, and I want y'all to realize that.
Yeah, well, let's look at the attendance at the WNBA games that did not have Caitlin Clark there. I'm not being a jerk, but let's just be real. I'm looking at a string of them. The highest one was 10,207. The lowest was like 3. I mean, on average, it was probably 6,000. The attendance at the WNBA games with Caitlin Clark on the court, 17,274, and last week in 17,401.
Numbers don't lie.
Yeah, numbers don't lie. That's it. You know, everybody, you should be figuring out. And I will say the one thing I like what you said, what Angel Reese said there. She's like, well, if I got to be the bad guy, because it's nice to have a good guy and a bad guy, right? But yeah, but also let's realize that it is actually because of Caitlin Clark. And it's not wrong to say something like that. Like, it wasn't wrong for Tiger Woods to completely, you know, revolutionize and modernize golf and make it mainstream and accessible to younger people. And a lot more. I mean, there's nothing wrong with acknowledging stuff like that. Don't got to be petty. And sadly, I do think race has a little bit of a factor into this. It shouldn't. You know, like, just like you would cheer for Tiger Woods, maybe, like, acknowledge Caitlin Clark. We got a second hour on the way. Stick with it. So for 10 years, Patriot Mobile has been America's only Christian conservative wireless provider. And when I say only, I mean literally, they are the only one. Patriot Mobile offers dependable nationwide coverage, and it gives you the ability to access all three major networks, which means you get the same coverage that you're accustomed to, but you're not funding the commies. And when you switch to Patriot Mobile, you're sending the message that you support free speech and religious freedom and the sanctity of life and the Second Amendment and our military and veterans and first responders and paying less money in a Biden inflation economy. Patriot Mobile has been my personal cell phone provider for years, and I love my service, and that's not because I know where the founder lives. It's peace of mind knowing that I can call their 100% U.S.-based customer service folks anytime that I need any kind of help or if I have any kind of questions or if I'm traveling and I need to let them know for international coverage. It's super easy to use Patriot Mobile and affordable. So visit patriotmobile.com/Dana or call 972-PATRIOT and get free activation when you drop my name, offer code Dana.
Hey, it's Dad again. I'm down at Newport News, Virginia. It's about 4 o'clock. Just call and check. Just text me or something to let me know you're okay. Okay, I love you. It's Dad. I called to tell you I love you. I love you more than the whole world, pal. Gotta get some help. I don't know what to do. I know you don't either. But I'm here. No matter what you need, I love you.
Oh my gosh. So I honestly think they're releasing this to try to make him look like he's a sympathetic figure. He's just this, that was Joe Biden leaving a voicemail on Hunter Biden's, it's on his laptop too, which I find weird. Who saves this? How is that saved? Is that just like his voicemail saved on that?
I don't think any of my voicemails are saved.
It's weird. Yeah, it was done in 2018, like the exact time that he was high as a kite, buying guns and doing drugs. And he left that voicemail for Hunter Biden, and that came out from the laptop. And apparently the prosecution has that, but it hasn't been entered as evidence yet. Welcome back to the show. Dana Loesch with you. Top of the second hour. We got the Hunter Biden trail. You got the Merrick Garland thing. You got the executive action that Joe Biden couldn't do on immigration. Now he can do. We'll talk about that here in a little bit coming up. We got a lot to hit. And then, I don't even want to know what's all on that laptop. I don't even.
We have a good idea.
Yeah, I just. There's no such thing as brain bleach. Now, Juan says, yeah, they sync messages and all that kind of stuff. So I get that. But you know what is weird, though, and what they don't sync are all the things that he recorded on his phone and then saved to his laptop.
Right.
So gross. So gross. Just
how many people film themselves doing things like felonies?
He filmed himself arguing with a hooker.
Yeah,
and saved it.
And admitting to getting like robbed or something, or I don't know what the
heck. Like he was weighing out his drugs, arguing with a hooker. Like, look what I got. Who does that? That's so weird. Why is he? Anyway, welcome to the program, Dana Loesch with you. Listen coast to coast. Terrestrially, you can also watch Channel 347, the simulcast of the radio program as well. So that's the thing on the voicemail telling Hunter Biden to get some help. Pretty amazing, telling Hunter Biden that he needs to get some help. The fact that this is all still, again, that we're in court with all of this, and you got Dexter Taylor who's sitting there. Yeah. Thomas Massie was talking about a little earlier. He was in a hearing where he was discussing how the Department of Veteran Affairs, they would weaponize anybody who was adjudicated as anything, whether it was mental. Or you remember back under Obama Biden when they were claiming that if you were a Social Security beneficiary and you had to have help with your finances, that was going to be counted as a disqualifying factor against you when it concerned your firearm ownership and your Second Amendment natural rights. And how everybody was, you know, rightfully, deservedly so, including myself, up in arms over that. fast forward to now, and you got Hunter Biden, that they're having, I mean, we're having to take great pains just to have the basic law formed. Basic law formed and determined against him. Like, it's wild, the difference here. It's absolutely wild. The difference in the two-tiered standard of justice is, you know, ultimately it. So, I don't know. We're going to see how this goes. The prosecution began their opening arguments today. They seated the jury yesterday. Lorraine has a really good deep dive over at the show Substack, Chapter and Verse, that gets into who the jurors are. And she noted, which I thought was a really good point, we knew everything about the Trump jurors even before everybody was seated. And we barely know. We only know the bare minimum about this jury.
Also,
yes, Kane.
In the Hunter's jury, there's like drug addicts and drug addicts in the family and people who are victims of guns, things of that nature. But in Trump's jury, there wasn't any business people who dealt with banks or real estate or even like campaign money or financing or any of the sort. They were literally just picked because they voted Democrat or essentially donated to Democrats at one point. Yeah. It's really weird.
Yeah. It's pretty amazing.
And they keep saying jury of his peers. Whenever they say a convicted felon, convicted by a jury of his peers, and he wasn't.
He was not. That's it. Because they, and looking into this, and I'm looking at the piece now, there were people that had history of drug use, people whose family had history of drug use. There were people who owned firearms, people who were kind of, who didn't own firearms. There's quite a bit. So it seemed like it really ran the spectrum of, every aspect of this case. Like, there's somebody who has something relatable in every bit of it. So it's very interesting. So we're going to continue watching this in addition to watching, waiting for Biden to sign this. It's an amnesty issue, and we're going to deep dive into that. Speaking of guns and firearms, can we play, where is this at? Audio soundbite 9, please. So Claire McCaskill, the former senator out of Missouri who was displaced during the election by voters by now Senator Josh Hawley, who was the former AG of Missouri. She was on MSNBC. Listen to what she says here, please.
And the irony here, I mean, let's step back for a minute and think about this. It's a gun charge. Now, understand that what the Republicans want to do is allow everyone to buy guns everywhere without ever having to tell the federal government anything.
Right.
They are so totally opposed to the idea that the federal government gets to know anything about them and their gun purchases. They don't believe in the law that he is being prosecuted under.
And that's like supposed to be some gotcha. No, that's not what this is about. This has nothing to do with whether or not you believe in the law. We believe in the law in which he's being prosecuted under, Claire. It's that this is your law and you believe in it. And we're making you be honest about it. That's what we're doing. There's a big difference here. This has nothing to do with us and our belief, disbelief, support, or opposition to this law. See, the thing is, Claire, is that this is your law that y'all wanted. It's your law that y'all wanted to increase penalties for. It's your law that y'all say is going to prevent violence and save lives. And now you have the president's son who is being charged with a crime due to violation of that law. The law that you say that you need, the law that you wanted, the law that you say you're going to abide by, and you insist that it's Republicans that have the issue with it. But really, the question, Claire, is that you have a problem with the law. I don't think that you believe the things that you're saying. I believe that you say that you want all these gun laws and that you want to do something about violence and crime, but yet you also believe that people should be accepted. There should be exceptions, exclusions from having to be equal under the law based on who you're born to. That's what it sounds like you're saying. So which is it? Do you think that some people are above the law because of their DNA? Do you think that some people are above the law? Is Hunter Biden above the law because he's a white 50-something-year-old son of Joe Biden? Is he more above the law than Dexter Taylor, who's not done drugs and who has a completely clean criminal record and actually was engaged in a federally protected hobby activity that's still federally protected, which is why this case is going to be litigated six ways to Sunday? But do you think that, does she think that Dexter Taylor is less equal before the law because he's black and not the son of Joe Biden? I mean, that's the question ultimately, isn't it? No, this is about making Democrats own their policies. It's about making Democrats stand their ground, so to speak. It's about making Democrats be honest about what they believe in and what they really would like to do. You don't get to be like, no, 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 not this time because it's Hunter Biden. No, we're going to make you own it. You wanted this law, and by God, you're going to hug every part of it. You're going to own every single part of it. You will feel the full force of the penalty when you break it, too. Because, as we like to say on the program, Dems de rules. Now, with that, we also have Dems de rules with immigration. And Joe Biden, ooh, wait real quick before I go to there. Back up for a minute. Did you hear what happened outside of the courtroom? This was today, correct? Yes, it was today. Oh, boy. Did you hear what happened outside of the courtroom today? Did you hear? So Hunter Biden's wife now, she's a Instagram influencer. Right around, yeah. She approached a former Donald Trump White House aide named Garrett Ziegler and yelled at him that he was a Nazi piece of redacted who had no right watching the case. And she did this while she was walking into the courtroom with the first lady. Trash attracts trash, does it not? It reminds me of a scene from a show that my mother loved to watch, and I loved to watch it because I watched it with her, and I really ended up appreciating this very strong female character that was played by Dixie Carter. It's a show called... was called Designing Women. Interestingly enough, it was created, the Bloodworth Thomasons, who were apparently big Arkansas Clinton supporters, but I think they were moderate Democrats. Anyway, Julia Sugarbaker was the woman in question, and I'll never forget the one scene in which she met a woman who was trying to be Julia's rival and literally had not even an ounce of her flame. And Julia remarked to her, in a wonderful fashion, she said, "You know what, growing up as a girl in rural Georgia, I have seen..." She's talking about fertilizer. "I've seen it tilled far and wide across every field and plain, but until this very moment, I have not seen it tied up in so attractive and pretty a package." And she said, "Bravo." She goes, "But it's still fertilizer." It's one of the best monologues. I thought of that when I was looking at Melissa Cohen, his Instagram influencer wife. I mean, you can take the girl out of mediocrity and you can put a brand new, barely broken in Chanel bag on her shoulder, and you can put in a wrinkled silk blouse on, you know, on her waist, and you can put in a lilac covered jacket that doesn't fit her very well and some, you know, kind of like too high in the waist pants. And you can try to sit here and adopt all the labels and dress the part and do all this other stuff because your lifestyle is entirely funded by 60-something-year-old sugar brother, which is embarrassing enough by itself, but it's still mediocrity. Fascinating stuff. I mean, can I just add one more thing about this? Clearly, she's with him because of access to power, power adjacency. Look at Hunter Biden, and she's not ugly. I mean, she looks plasticine, but some guys like that. But I guess... you know, you have to have an absence of self-awareness and self-respect to be with a man who can't even afford your tastes, can't afford your lifestyle, can't even afford his, which is why he has a 60-something-year-old Big Lebowski-looking guy who is his quote-unquote sugar brother and literally finances his entire life, subsidizes his entire life to the tune of millions. How is that attractive, knowing that the man that you married, who put a ring that's another man paid for on your finger, can't even actually provide for you? I find that he doesn't handle anything in this family. How disgusting is that? Doesn't it just make your ovaries like squeal in terror? Oh my gosh. All right, we got to get moving. If you haven't had Black Rifle Coffee yet, now is the perfect time to taste why they're becoming one of the most popular coffee companies in America. Black Rifle Coffee Company is veteran founded, veteran run, and every purchase you make helps fuel their mission to support veteran and first responder causes. And that includes getting much needed equipment to first responders, helping vets fight cancer, and so much more. Black Rifle serves a wide variety of ground coffee, whole bean, K-cups, and ready-to-drink coffee for those on the go. Everything from the roast to the bag art pays homage to American culture and military history, and every bag is roasted right here in America. Black Rifle is the go-to in my house, and it keeps me going all day through every broadcast, and you can have Black Rifle Coffee as well. Make sure you visit blackriflecoffee.com, order today, and get 20% off using code Dana. Again, save 20% off using code Dana at blackriflecoffee.com.
All of the news you would probably miss. It's time for Dana's Quick Five.
I really don't want anybody doing this because I just don't care. Nobody cares about your private lives. Now an Idaho bar is celebrating Heterosexual Awesomeness Month in June. You knew it was going to happen. It's the Old State Saloon in the city of Eagle. They said every Monday in June is Hetero Male Monday. Any heterosexual male dressed like a heterosexual male, the bar said. It's kind of funny. They said that they even put out a call seeking a professional, that's their word, quote, judge, qualified to determine if men's chosen clothing is officially heterosexual. And then they offered a $15 per hour plus free beer as compensation to anyone who thinks you have what it takes to determine straight threads. Heterosexuals, couples get 15% off their bill. And then Thursday nights are heterosexual ladies' nights with her hetero happy hour.
I'm for it because this isn't anti-anything.
I think it's funny.
It's for
the her. Now, because of the name and the tongue-in-cheek, I get it. It's funny. Her hetero happy hour is actually hysterical and should be on a t-shirt. So they said they had 2,000 comments and people were like, oh, it's bigotry because someone, they're mad. How is it bigotry? You just decided to go and have your Accutane rage, Midol fueled tantrum in the comments. Like, what the hell's the matter with you? Stop it. I think it's funny, right? We're going to talk more about this coming up. Can we stop trying to pet bison? Please. Because now an elderly woman was injured. She got gored by a bison defending its space at Yellowstone. Stop trying to pet it. Stop it. I mean, it's a giant beast. You know, they said that the bison was defending its space. Sadly, it lifted her about a foot off the ground with its horns. It's just so bad. You know, that was heinous. She was taken by helicopter. Didn't make it. But they said they'd tell people, stay 75 feet away from the animals. These things are like 2,000 pounds. They're 6 feet tall. Stop it. Yeah, especially if you're 83. Quit trying to pet them. What is wrong? And Hawaii's Kilauea volcano erupted in a remote part of a national park. Low eruptive volume, they say. So just a little bit of the lava. Not a lot of the lava. Stick with us. So you know how important being prepared is to me, and that's why I want you to know about my good friends at ReadyWise Emergency Food. Now, you've heard me talk about them as Wise Foods. ReadyWise Emergency Food is the same company, but with more options. Being prepared with ReadyWise Emergency Food gives you peace of mind that you'll have delicious, nutritious meals on hand to feed your family. They're also great for fishing and hunting and hiking adventures. They have a huge selection of freeze-dried meals from breakfast to pasta dishes that'll be good to eat when you need it with their 25-year shelf life. ReadyWise is an American company, so that means you're supporting American jobs when you choose ReadyWise. Visit ReadyWise.com and use promo code Dana20 at checkout for 20% off of any regularly priced item. That's ReadyWise.com, promo code Dana20. Welcome back to the program. Dana Loesch with you. The Texas Rangers apparently are the only Major League Baseball team without a quote-unquote Pride night. They've changed their website banner to run it back to Straight Up Texas. It's actually funny. But that's a saying. That's a saying that they've had for a long time. That's not new. And I was reading this one Dallas sports writer who was saying, it's really unfortunate. It feels antagonistic. Super antagonistic. Good for the Rangers, though. Not everything has to celebrate how you have sex. Somebody got mad at me for saying that. They're like, you know, I was really getting tired of all the pride stuff. Then I saw your comment and it was so ignorant. It's about so much more than sex. Is it? Then what's it about? Do they sprout up another head that gives them like extra power? What? What is it about if it's not about how you get it on? Kane, any ideas?
Gosh, I don't Any? Know. Fashion, maybe? I don't
Do they turn into aliens?
Maybe fashion?
Does their yeah. skin go green like a Martian? Like, what's up?
They've turned into aliens already.
What is up? What's up, Denny's? What's up? For real. What? Someone's like, how far we have to go? What do you mean how far we have to go? You're using baseball. People are getting mad at a baseball team because they're not affirming how someone chooses to have sex. And that's what it's about. What is it if it's not about sex?
And when did it actually, the moment, become so offensive? Like, yeah. And antagonistic, as they described it. When did that happen?
If you're not celebrating how I have sex, you're a bigot. What? Shut up. Touch grass. What's the matter with you? Get so hung up on everything. Who gets mad if they go into a Target and is like, I don't see rainbow things. Everything has to have a symbol on it affirming how I have sex. Stop. You're the freak. If you're at that point where you have to see, say it. I double dog dare you. No. I triple dog no. dare you.
No.
You can't say no to a triple dog dare.
Do it. Historically, that
you
is
put
accurate.
It in Slack.
All right. I said touch grass, not ass.
Thank you.
Groomer Awareness Month.
Groomer Awareness Month. I mean, it's that's what it's about, though. They're mad because they didn't have rainbow stuff on their uniform. They don't have rainbow stuff on their website. They don't have blah, blah. They don't have a pride night. What does that even mean? Pride is not a virtue either, by the way. What does that even mean? It's just so over the top. It's so over the top. They had, it's gone from, like, if you don't affirm it, then you're the enemy. They had, I'm pulling this up. Where was the, I saw the thing. Let me find this. It was the Navy.
Excuse me, it's ma'am. It is ma'am. I'm
telling you. They required it. Even the Navy SEALs, for some reason. The Defense Department mixed up Pride and PTSD Month.
No.
I'm going to need to grab a table. What? They did.
Or did they?
Yeah. It said they marked the start of June with a Facebook post celebrating the beginning of Pride Month. It was the post on the official page of Naval Special Warfare Command. And it was also posted on the U.S. Navy SEALs page as. And it spelled out the words dignity, service, respect, equality, pride in rainbow-colored letters. And, oh my gosh, that's what they used. What does this have to do with going out and just doing your job as members of the military? People were infuriated because June 6th is D-Day. We're days away. The 80th anniversary of D-Day. And this is what you're doing? D-Day gets one day to remember. If you choose to have sex a certain way, you get a whole month. Do you see how ridiculous this is? No pun intended. And every SEAL I know was livid. And they had the Progress Pride flag and Celebrate Pride. They had, like, multiple posts about it, apparently. And in the meantime, you get, like, one thing said on, you know, June 6th, just in a couple of days, for D-Day. That's it. That's all you get. It is so over the top. And then when they did PTSD, they said June is they had a separate thing, Department of Defense. They tweeted, June is PTSD Awareness Month. And the DOD is committed to supporting service members and veterans affected by PTSD. If you or someone you know struggling. And then they had a Celebrate Pride graphic on that they attached to it. So they couldn't even celebrate PTSD without trying to put, they had to put in a pride thing. In everything that they did, they had to put in a pride thing. Oh my gosh. Someone wrote, thanks for recognizing our strength is our differences. That's like the opposite of military. Wow. You stolen valor. What in the world? That's the absolute opposite. It's the unity. And I mean, it's again, it reminds me of that scene. Zack Snyder's 300. Where the one guy is asking Leonidas, he's like, look, I want to serve. I want to be a part. And he's like, you can't raise your shield. He's like, no offense. You know, you can help this way, but you know, I can't have, and it's through no fault of your own. I have to have a completely uniform fighting force. That's the way it is. If the fighting isn't your main objective, you're not in the right place. And I would put that with us. No one cares what you want to do in your personal time. You make an idol of all of this stuff that has nothing to do with warfare. You make an idol out of all of these things that have nothing to do with eliminating enemies and saving lives. None of it. And when you do that, you're not prioritizing your team first. You're not prioritizing your mission first. You are stupidly prioritizing how you get it on first. That's dangerous and dumb. I just can't believe that they did it with PTSD. It's just stupid. This is what I never understood growing up. Because growing up, it was always, we were told that there was no difference and it needs to be treated the same as everything else. But then every action they have taken in terms of advocacy for same-sex anything has been the complete opposite of that. Every action that they have taken with advocacy has been all about separating it, elevating it above the law even, making it a protected class apart from everyone else, giving the demo special accommodations. They've done absolutely antithetical to everything that they said that was intended in the beginning. It wasn't about making it the same. It was about making it separate. And they continue to do that today to the point where it's so egregious, you almost have to stop and ask, are they doing it to make you dislike it so that then they can claim that your dislike of it due to the oversaturation is because of your bigotry and not their oversaturation? You see what I'm saying? It's almost like a psyop. Purposely, they want to cause division and then claim that you're the problem. And to do this with military, especially when we're days away from June 6th, and they have multiple posts on this stuff. Think about it. How many posts do you usually see from these agencies about D-Day? You get one, right? Memorial Day, you get one. Veterans Day, you get one. Armed Services Day, you get one. That's it. That's the problem. They try to elevate it and act like it's separate and apart and above everything else. And that's an issue. That's a problem. They don't need to be doing it with the Navy SEALs for the love. I wanted to show you this. Goodness. Couple of things here. This was from Sky News, because we're going to get into some of the Gaza stuff and all that later. They had the headline where IDF found four hostages in Gaza. They were killed. They're dead. It's sad. And I honestly think that most of the others are as well. So they had this story from Sky News, and it says Israeli man who went missing during Hamas attack found dead. Now, just process this sentence for a moment from this tweet. Israeli man who went missing during Hamas attack found dead. Well, how did he go missing? It was during Hamas's terror attack. How did this Israeli man go missing? Oh, they kidnapped him. Hamas did. They kidnapped him and held him hostage, and he didn't survive being in their custody. But they gloss over it by saying he just went missing. What? He just went missing. That's not what kidnapped is, though, right? That's something entirely different. But that's how they put it. I've seen other, and I'm actually looking at my collection of bookmarks. There's actually several other news agencies that did the exact same thing. Oh, these missing Israelis. Why were they missing? Kane, why were they missing? You remember?
Yeah, I remember there was a deliberate violation of a ceasefire by Hamas. Mm. And they entered in, parasailing in, to a concert of innocents. It's not like they attacked an actual military facility or anything like that. It wasn't anything like that. They took nothing but civilians hostage, killed a bunch, just wreaked havoc on a music festival as they breached the ceasefire.
When these people went quote unquote missing, it's like they make it sound like they got lost. They were kidnapped by Hamas.
Yeah.
This is Sky News, and it's not just Sky. There were a lot of, there's too many to get into. That's how many there were with all of this. We have Florida Man on the way, and now we're watching as the president is preparing these this executive action on the border. Because remember, they were saying, well, a certain amount of illegal crossings a day is okay. But if it gets to this magic number, then we're going to have a problem. But he's acting as though he's never had the ability to do anything. And then now all of a sudden he's got the ability to do it. He's admitting that Trump was right with all of these orders on with his policy on immigration. And the media is not saying a damn thing about it. They're not talking about how Joe Biden has done a total 180 on immigration policy and is having to he's reauthorizing Trump's orders via executive order, the ones that he rolled back his first week in office. And the press is giving him a total pass for this. You do not hate the press enough. Thanks for watching The Dana Show. Make sure to like, subscribe, ring the bell, and stay tuned for more content.